So welcome to our second podcast, Undistilled Engineering. I'm delighted to welcome David Bage, welding engineer. Been at TWI for 14 years, David?
That's correct, yes.
And Jimmy Bell, ex-TWI, welding engineer with your own company,
yes.
Carbon Arc, which we'll talk about later. So I want to start, as we do with the podcast, is I want to find out about your careers, where you started, how you've got to where you are, and I think everything in between, all the fun things in between, and we'll explore different avenues, both personal and professional. But I really want to dig into your experiences. I think that's the fascinating thing here, and how you're connected. I'll start with you, David. So how did it all start, and why did you get into this profession, going right back to the start?
I think, like a lot of things, a bit by mistake. When I left school, I was doing I decided I wanted to go into agriculture, so I'd done a farm management program.
Right. Okay.
And then I realised a few months into it that I was never going to be able to manage a farm because I didn't have one.
Yeah.
You really had to own one to manage one.
So nobody told you that.
Yeah, they didn't tell me at the beginning. So I think I'd probably done that for almost a year, and then I decided that I would go back into education and do A-levels.
Yes.
And then I was with my mother on holiday in the northeast, where my family originates from, and I had an uncle that was a partner in an engineering company.
Yeah.
And when they went out for drinks one night, without me, they sealed my future and I was offered a welding apprenticeship in Teesside.
Right.
So that's how it started for me. I'd seen welding done, but had never done it before. I was quite looking forward to it. And
so how old were you then, David?
17.
And your uncle's business specifically was...
Basically, it done a lot of contract work in Teesside, which was, you know, we're talking about the late 70s. So
yeah.
There was many large organisations in Teesside then, engineering-wise. They still had the shipyards.
Yeah.
They had a place called ICI Wilton. There was Redpath Dorman Long, which built Sydney Harbour Bridge and the bridge over the Tyne. So some really big engineering companies, and basically we were sort of like contractors to them.
Yeah, okay.
Although I was lucky enough, he got a contract in the Shetland Isles, so I think I was still 17, so I went to the Shetland Isles for 3 months, which was quite an experience.
Right, and what was your objective? What were you doing?
The Shetland Isles then was famous for a place called Solemn Vaux, which was on the main island, where they were building an oil terminal.
Right.
But we weren't on that contract. We were on the most northern isle of the Shetland Isles, and they were building early warning radar stations, because this obviously was during the time of the Cold War.
The Cold War, yeah.
So that's what I was doing.
And, right.
Yeah, it was quite an experience. I think I was working with some highly skilled welders at the time, and I was doing day release to college as well.
Yeah.
In Teesside. But over a period of time, I actually got homesick, you know, because I come from Norfolk, you know, and it's 200 and some odd miles away. After 2 years, I managed to have my apprenticeship continued by a local engineering company, which was in the road transport industry. So they made trailers, tippers, containers, and road tankers, petroleum tankers, you know, delivers fuel to the fuel stations.
Yeah, yeah.
So I was lucky enough to get it continued there. So I finished my apprenticeship, and I was lucky because I was exposed in those two places of work. I was exposed to many different welding processes and many different materials, which gave me a really good grounding for actually coming here.
Yeah.
So I think I was sort of like in my early 20s when I realized that, you know, I wanted to be a little bit more than just a welder.
Yeah.
Or I wanted to use my welding skills, which I'd developed by then.
Yeah.
So 21, 22. And I decided that, you know, there were some positions in South Africa. So applied to go there and was given...
So that would have been quite unusual in that time. Late 70s, early 80s?
This was now early 80s.
Early 80s,
yeah, yeah,
but still going and finding work.
Well, yeah, at the time there was, you know, it was a bit of a recession in the UK in the early 1980s.
But
my organisation that I worked for was going through a round of redundancies, so I could see that, oh, I'd been offered this position in South Africa, and there's some redundancy, so I could pick up some redundancy money, but there was a 9-month gap between the redundancy and me going to South Africa. So there were some jobs in the North Sea oil and gas sector at Great Yarmouth, so that's where I went. So I worked for a couple of organisations there before I went to South Africa, making drilling rigs, which was a new experience to me altogether.
So you've worked with lots of different materials, you've worked in transport sector, your second role, your uncle's firm, which was kind of fabrication, I'm guessing, of structures.
A lot of pipe work.
Yeah.
They've basically done anything, really.
Yeah, contractors
cover it.
And then you get this third experience, which is real, pure oil and gas, with the potential, or had you signed up to go to South Africa at that point?
Yeah, I was just waiting. Yeah, I was just waiting for
the
formalities to go through, and I got married as well.
Yeah.
And so I went to South Africa as a couple, and I worked for South African Telecom in Johannesburg.
Right, okay.
Which again was another experience, but basically they had a fabrication sector.
Yeah.
And South African Telecom covered the post office as well. As it was here many years ago, post office and telecommunications used to be one entity.
Yeah.
And again, it was fabrication, welding and fabrication, going into some very strange places like the townships around South Africa.
Yeah.
Because we had to maintain their telecommunication systems as well. A lot of it was security work. But it was quite an experience. And so I spent a few years there. Again, got homesick again.
Yeah.
Although the climate was great. And came back had a couple of jobs before I went back to my original company in the transport sector. But one of those jobs that I had was actually building tanks, what they call a tank farm, but basically this is where most of your diesel and petrol is actually stored.
Right.
So I had almost a year on that contract, so it was another form of welding and fabrication, which included, you know, x-rays and things like that, which I really hadn't come across before.
Yeah, so further experience on different specialities.
Yes.
Okay.
Eventually, I went back to the organisation in the transport sector, and they were quite a large organisation. You know, they had factories in Lancashire, two in Norfolk, and they were part of a worldwide group, which was American-owned.
Yeah.
And so they had their own welding school. So they actually trained their own welders on two of the sites. And I think I'd been back maybe a year or two where they said, you know, there was a welding instructor's position coming up. Would you like to apply? And I thought, why are they asking me to apply? Well, they obviously wanted me for the position, I guess.
Yeah.
So I applied for this welding instructor position and I got it. So we were basically training people to weld from scratch, but also improving some of their skills as well, you know, and also testing welders, which was something new to me.
Right.
And I was running two welding schools on two sites, and I think I've probably done that for seven or eight years. So, and I liked the teaching element as well. I quite enjoyed that.
So are we late 80s now?
Yes, we're into the late 80s, yeah.
And what was, Tell us some of the stories from those. You know, that's quite a bit of an experience. Is there anything that really stood out on your journey? People you met?
Yeah, you've heard the term, he's a natural. You know, he's never done something before.
Yeah.
And you show them something, i.e. welding, and the guy can just do it straight away. I came across a person like that. So I'd heard these stories, but never experienced it before. And I got this group of four people to train to weld, as I normally did, and I had 2 or 3 weeks to make them welders of a sort. And this one guy, within 2 or 3 days, could do everything that I could do, which had taken me years and years. And I realized what I had, and so I informed management about this guy. And so they said, right, well, teach him this, and teach him this, and teach him this while you have him. And I think within the 3 weeks I had him, he could do 3 or 4 processes on 3 or 4 materials, which was unheard of. It took people years to do this. Yeah. But he just had this natural gift.
And what did he go on to do?
He became a market gardener.
Oh, right. Okay. I know. He's obviously talented.
He was very, very talented. And he became, and he has a market garden now. I know where it is.
Right,
and,
okay.
I sometimes bump into him.
Yeah.
He's just one of these. And when I say, you know, gifted, I guess probably in my time of welding instruction, I probably instructed hundreds of people.
Yeah.
And just this one.
Right.
Was this natural guy. So from that, the organisation changed slightly, and eventually I became their welding engineer. So not officially I was their welding engineer, but you could basically state, well, not a qualified welding engineer. But I operated as a welding engineer, so I had to produce welding procedures, quality systems for welding, inspection systems for welding, qualify welders, and sort of find issues on the shop floor which needed some sort of control, and quite frequently there you had to problem solve.
Yeah.
They looked to you to solve a problem.
Yes.
Maybe that you hadn't come across before.
Yeah, yeah.
So you sometimes were relying on other people. And again, the organization was going through some dramatic changes where they were spending a lot of money on new forms of welding, new equipment. They were members of TWI as well. So we had that link. And I believe TWI actually initially helped them set up the welding school.
Right.
Many, many years before I was there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like a lot of organizations, you know, there were manufacturing issues, warranty issues, so I was involved in those as well. But I think the biggest thing was it was the introduction of new processes where it allowed me to visit some of our sister companies in France, so I could see new techniques and things like that. It was quite an enjoyable period. But again, like anything, you're always looking at what's around the corner. And I sort of fell in love with the teaching side from being the welding instructor.
Yes.
So all of a sudden I decided, and I was lucky enough, I'd done a degree with the Open University. So I thought, how do you get into teaching? How do I become a high school teacher? So I went down that route next. So I done what they call the graduate training program. In school in Norwich, and so I done teacher training for a few years, but I found that hard work. Found that was the hardest job I'd ever had to do.
So you've got all this experience in industry, mm-hmm. within SMEs,
yeah,
across multi sectors, multi materials, multi techniques, and then you go jump into teacher training. Mm-hmm. So, what, you know, tell us the motivation behind that.
I'd actually always had a love of history, and which I still have.
Yeah.
And history is a fantastic subject to teach.
And is this an itch you always had?
Yeah, I did. I'd always had this.
Yeah.
Because I had an exceptional history teacher when I was at high school. And I think that's what made me fell in love with history and teaching it. But, you know, it's probably the hardest job in the world, teaching in a high school.
Yeah.
It's really demanding. I probably got into it too late in life.
Was that in Norfolk?
That was in Norfolk, yes.
And you'd come in as a history teacher, just teaching history, or were you?
Yes, I done a little bit of that. I did teach a little bit of sociology as well.
Yeah.
And I found actually the older the students were, i.e. sixth formers, it was easier to teach them. You didn't have the discipline issues, I'll call them.
Yeah.
So I realised that the job was very demanding and very draining. So I moved from there to a technical college, back teaching engineering again.
So you loved the potential and you loved the thought of teaching history.
Yes.
The glamour of that and linking that to your passion.
Yes.
But the reality was, the discipline was very tough. That was making you fall out of love with teaching.
It was, it was, believe it or not, it was physically demanding.
Yeah.
I can recall finishing work on a Friday afternoon, and I lived about 20 miles from the school, not knowing how I got home. I was that drained.
Right.
That drained, and I realised why teachers have 14 weeks holiday a year now.
Yeah. My father was a chemistry teacher at high school, and I used to see he'd finish at 3:30, but we'd be home, and he'd have his books out in the olden days, sat at the kitchen table, and he'd go to late in the evening, marking books.
Yeah.
And I realise now it's because he was doing it properly and thoroughly, and there was a volume of work outside the teaching hours. I only realised that later in life.
And you'll jump in and say, he doesn't stop teaching history now.
Oh, is it?
Working with him, it's every day, still. So he hasn't given it up by any means whatsoever.
What part of history do you love then? What period?
Oh, that's a difficult one. Probably where, they're all linked together, believe it or not. I was talking to Jimmy yesterday about the Magna Carta, which was, what date was it, Jimmy?
I didn't know I was going to get an exam here.
It was 1215.
Because that was 100 year old, wasn't it?
And that has got links to lots of other things, if you look into it. But I guess things like some of the significant changes in British history, things like the Tudor period and the Reformation, and the Industrial Revolution, because they're sort of linked, believe it or not, as well.
Yes.
And probably that period, so sort of 1500s through to the 1700s. Although I like it all. I like the Wars of the Roses and things like that.
But the Industrial Revolution obviously links to your interest in engineering, I'm guessing.
Yes. Yes, it does.
I'm guessing you like the great Fred Dibner.
Yes. The guy that climbed the chimneys.
Fabulous natural engineer.
Yes, he was.
And I think he spent 20 or 30 years building his own steam engine.
Correct,
I think he did a couple in the end, just tirelessly working.
I've got a friend like that, actually.
Yeah.
And he's built his own steam engine.
And I think those are the natural people you're talking about.
Yeah.
That they just absorb they have an instinct for the mechanical side and how materials work together, connect together, and interlink. I think
it was right early in my apprenticeship, I was working with this extremely good welder, and he said to me that to become a good welder, you've really got to have a relationship with the material. that's a good way of putting it. But yes, a good way of putting it. Yes. Yeah. Indeed.
In the way a botanist, they have a relationship with the flowers and the plants.
Yes.
On a different level.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Indeed. Yeah. So I ended up at a technical college. So I was teaching older students. It was a little bit better. It was a little bit better, but it was still hard work. And I knew of TWI because I'd been here on inspection courses and the welding diploma courses. Yeah. So I'd been here, well, for weeks and weeks and weeks, months basically.
Yeah.
So I just went onto the website and I was sort of looking for any position, and there it was. There it was. You know, we were looking for a welding lecturer at Cambridge. So I applied, and I was offered the job straight after the interview.
Right. Okay.
And the reason why I'm sort of mentioning it is because within a month, we were running the Indian operation, mainly welding inspection, Eastwick welding inspection. So within a month, I was sent to India for 3 weeks. And the link here is me teaching in a high school and teaching in India, classes of 25 adults.
Yes.
It was like teaching heaven. It was completely different. You walked in the room, they all stood up.
Yeah.
There was a lot of respect. They listened to every word you said.
They wanted to be there to learn.
Certainly.
Is that because of, to pay the price to get on the course was a big investment?
It is, but I think generally you find that you're teaching people now that have paid.
Yeah.
And and it's a big investment for them, whether it's in the UK or anywhere else in the world.
Yeah.
And you know you've got a captive audience.
And they're highly motivated.
They're highly motivated. Yeah. And if I compare that to teaching high school children, you always have to find a hook. You have to hook them at the beginning to keep their attention. Yeah. Don't need that with this.
Yes.
The hook's there all the time.
And the hook for them would be, so doing the welding diploma or a high-level inspection course, the hook for those students in India, would that give them the opportunity to go and work in the Middle East?
Mostly, yes.
For a big oil and gas company?
Yes.
And change their lives?
Oh, yes, definitely life-changing.
Yeah.
Life-changing for them. I think I heard things like, you know, it's 3 or 4 times their salary.
Yeah. And then that would open up other avenues and
for other members of their family, etc. as well. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's quite a significant change for them.
Yeah. So at that time, TWI were in India. Obviously, was that a new initiative?
I think they'd been there a few years before, but the business was increasing dramatically.
Yeah.
I think there were probably maximum 4 of us in the UK that were lecturing welding inspection. At any given time, there was one of us there.
Right. And was it solely India? Were we in Southeast Asia at that point?
Southeast Asia already had their own operation.
Was established.
Yeah. We did go to South Africa, though.
Yeah.
We were covering South Africa as well and bits of Europe.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Interesting. And then, I'm aware that you've been to India on many occasions.
Mm-hmm.
And that became a bit of a habit. You were there every 3 or 4 months?
At least, I think I have looked at my old passport and I've probably been there 30 times, I would guess, something like that.
So you've worn off the homesickness in later life.
Yeah. Well, there were, the maximum period of time you were there was 3 weeks.
Yeah.
But I've been lucky enough to go to Southeast Asia a lot as well.
Yes.
And it's quite strange that the world of welding is quite small.
Yeah.
And why I mention this is that I think I said, you know, when I first became a welding engineer, that we were introducing new processes. Well, the company that we bought these processes off was French.
Yeah.
And so they had an office in the UK, and the guy that worked there that I dealt with had also worked here before me.
Yeah.
But anyway, he took me to France. He could speak fluent French. I happened to bump into him in Malaysia,
right?
because he'd then become opened up an office for this French company that was selling this automated welding equipment there.
Yeah.
And every now and again, I bump into somebody that I know. As I say, the welding industry, it's quite small. And I think 3 weeks ago, we had a C-SWIP welding inspection course here, and it was somebody that I taught as an apprentice.
So it's on the course. Small community.
Yeah, and that's the third time
spread
it's happened
globally.
That I've right. come across somebody that I taught as an apprentice.
Yeah, yeah.
Here, three times it's happened. So it's a fairly small community.
And they all remember you for the history you taught as well, not just the inspection course.
When I do teach, which it is not so common now, because I sort of manage welding inspection and the welding diploma, if I do, I try and bring a little bit in.
Yeah.
I can, yeah.
Make it interesting.
Yeah, make it interesting. Because some of the standards use numbers, and some of those numbers are like significant dates in history, so
yeah.
I try and link them like
try
that.
It, yeah.
Yeah.
So, going back to India over the time you've visited and taught and managed the teaching, what's changed on the subcontinent in respect of standards, health and safety? Because I'm aware of the CSIP project we have with Lloyd's Register Foundation.
Yes.
And the investment that Lloyd's put into that.
Mm-hmm.
What's changed in your eyes over that time, and where's it going?
Well, from what I can understand with the Indian business, because they're now self-sustainable, they sustain themselves.
Yeah.
The Indian business that we do is the biggest regional growth of anywhere.
Yes.
It's bigger than Southeast Asia.
And that's a demand and a thirst from India to be self-sufficient.
I think so.
Yeah, that's where it's driving.
So they where they were heavily reliant on us, they're not anymore.
Right.
In terms of size, probably what we do in the UK, they're doing six times what we do.
Right.
Now.
And that leads to British companies like JCB.
Correct.
Finding it quite easier to put several plants in India.
Yes.
Because there's a trained workforce.
Yes.
Is that the link there?
Yeah. I think they've opened at least two factories.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
And they're confident they've got the skills locally.
Yes.
That's the key.
Yes.
Which they wouldn't have had 20 years ago.
I don't think they would have
done
that.
Not in the volume.
No, I don't think they would.
Yeah. Going back to Teesside then, and Jimmy can come in here. I saw you at the Northumbria TUI branch event, mm-hmm. Jimmy, and there was a lot of discussion about, I think from UK Skills, there's an outreach to get, I guess this affects both of you, to train the future generations and to make this a career in welding attractive. And Teesside, there was a big spotlight, and the rest of the Northeast. I think the lady from UK Skills, forgive me, I've forgotten her name, but there's a big push for industry to link up with the schools and the colleges to attract more apprenticeships and people into the industry, because there's a shortage. Is that
a
fair comment?
It is.
In that region,
We fall into that where it's not just welding, it's not just the industry we live in, it's engineering, full stop, isn't it? I do a bit of work with the STEM organisation, RTC, in Sunderland.
Yeah.
We're going into the schools and trying to get the kids to be engaged. And unfortunately, it seems to be a discussion we keep having. How do we get people to want to be in engineering? And then even if we can get them in engineering, all of that subdivision that is engineering is a thing. How do we then get them to be interested in what we still see is a relatively dirty, horrible industry of welding and fabrication?
Is that the blocker then?
I think
what do you both think?
I think it is. I think welding, generally it has been seen as somebody in dirty overalls,
yeah,
in a black shed,
yeah,
lighting it up every now and again when, yeah, he welds. It's not like that anymore.
No,
it's not.
The qualification is one thing,
yeah,
and we, I don't know if we get a little bit lost in it as an industry, you know, as we say, you know, absolutely there's the place for fully qualified, but what is fully qualified? Okay, we can go and do the IWA qualification, do a lot of that, and that's all really valuable, yeah, really good stuff to have, and it's the way of, you know, proven competence and all, yeah, yeah, the stuff that goes along with that. But welding engineering splits off into so many things.
Yeah.
You know, are you an EWE type qualified welding engineer who's doing mainly carbon steel, or are you doing more exotic stuff? Are you doing,
yeah,
you know, can you fall into the aerospace, yes, side of things, which is definitely engaging with the whole process a lot more nowadays? Yeah. And that does give you such a range of things. I would keep away naturally now myself, away from the sort of the what is the wage discussion, and say what's the lifestyle?
Yes.
You know, what does a life in welding engineering give you? And it's given me since 16 a really good lifestyle.
Yeah.
Where now, you know, I'm still finishing off my EWE, IWE, but it's, I can pick and choose what I want to do.
Yes.
You know, I can say, oh, well, I'm going to teach today, or I'm going to do welding engineering, I'm going to qualify some welders or some procedures, or write a specification for somebody,
yeah,
or be involved in the project for the next 6 months.
So that's given you an opportunity to develop your own business,
yes,
from scratch, yeah, which you're talking about, gives you a lifestyle and the freedom,
yeah, yeah,
to cross industry sector, yeah, teach.
So, you know, I think for me, COVID, the dreaded COVID word, has maybe shown a lot of people where maybe the ability to choose how we want to work has maybe changed.
Yeah.
And maybe the underlying wage you get, you find something you need to have and live, yeah, with and drive that. But welding engineering does give you an opportunity to, you know, Dave's explained how he's gone all over the world. I've managed to go all over the world. And
I think that's a very important point, and it should be hyped more. You talk, you know, both of you talking about the global travel as if it's just natural. And to me, that clearly describes that this role, you can spread your wings and, yeah, work in many sectors, work globally. You're talking about 30 visits to India, 3 weeks at a time, you know.
And all the stuff you get to see when you're there.
Yeah.
You know, if you use this, India as an example.
So how can this be... Because I would find that attractive if I'm a young fledgling scientist stroke engineer doing STEM subjects and having a passion for STEM subjects, that global travel would appeal to me. How can we reach out more and more from industry to change that perception,
yeah,
and to attract, you know, tomorrow's generation of welding engineers working in automotive, aerospace, energy, space, mm-hmm, medical? That's the question. How can we pull other careers?
Jimmy and myself sort of discussed this earlier, or maybe yesterday, about you know, what are the routes to a welding engineer?
Yeah.
And we basically came up with two routes, didn't we? So,
yeah,
so there's the route that Jimmy and myself took, which is more of a practical route, but,
yep,
having to take on academia, or there's the academic route, purely academic route.
Yep.
So basically, you've gone to university,
to mechanical engineering.
Mechanical engineer,
yeah,
you're working somewhere, and they say to you, well, we really need a welding engineer.
Yes.
And as you've got a degree in engineering, you could become a qualified, yeah, International Institute of Welding engineer.
Yes.
If you take this qualification that TWI, yep, do. But then there's the other route, the Jimmy and David, yeah, route, where you know we started off as welders, and then progressed, and we had to take on academia.
Yes.
Which is more difficult, but I think either route is okay. But if somebody was to ask me, of those two routes, which one makes the best welding engineer, I'm going to be biased and actually say it's the route that Jimmy and me took. But because I might not be right in every case.
Yeah.
Because as Jimmy said, welding engineering is so diverse. You know, you do need welding engineers that have got a very good background in metallurgy. Because, you know, they could be involved in using very exotic materials, which might be a bit beyond somebody that took the practical route.
Yeah.
So both routes are fine.
I think maybe we're not selling the process as well as we should. We're very much, of course, in all walks of life, is selling the end goal, aren't we? You know, stay in university, become a doctor, yeah. And at that point you will do all of this, or, yeah. You know, whatever we pick. If we were better maybe in the industry of saying, okay, for the next 4 years, so for me, from 16, I fell into apprenticeship. My mom gets the blame for everything on every course I teach, because I didn't want to stay at school. I hated school. I was very happy to get out. I'm dyslexic, everyone goes, I'm dyslexic, but I really hated it. Didn't get any support through school. And I remember very clearly, my mom just throwing a newspaper at us and saying, well, if you're not going back to school, you can apply for that. And I ended up in the training school at Vickers Tank Factory on the Tyne, yeah. Where they wanted me to be an electrician. Oh no, James, you need to be an electrician. You're really good at it, be an electrician. And for some reason, I just decided, no, I was going to be a welder. To this day, I don't know why. No, I'm going to do that. And if I look at it from that point, the journey, you know, because everybody needs a journey nowadays, don't we? Well, it doesn't get on the telly unless you've got a journey to tell, is that 4 years of my apprenticeship, okay, was great, but that's the stepping stone. That's the bit to saying, well, you know, it's 19 when I finished my apprenticeship, just about turned 20, I paid myself through my free one, my C-suit welding inspector course. Me and my girlfriend at the time, now being my wife for the last 20 years, you know, we paid for that, spent a fortune on it, passed it, and that's the next one. But what does that open up for us? You know, and you can, selling the, right, you do this bit, and then you have this opportunity, so you're not committing yourself to, oh, it's going to take you however many years to do it. It's like, okay, in 4 years' time, you can be doing this. And at this point, you could choose to do, you know, be aerospace, be nuclear.
Yeah.
Be, you know, and like, nuclear, great example. At the minute, I was talking to somebody a couple of weeks ago. It's like, okay, well, do this in 4 years' time, move into nuclear. And in itself, what you're going to do? Are you going to do new builds? Are you going to do decommissioning? All that needs welding engineering. It all needs those skills. From there, what are you going to do? So that moves us into 5, 6, 7 years from there. Oh, well, now I fancy doing teaching. Okay, what does teaching allow you to do? It's been a brilliant job for us the last, 15 years I've been doing teaching on and off, you know? So maybe we need to sell it in steps.
I think that's right, and that resonates with what you've said, David. It sounds like, talking about that journey, you were in steps, weren't you?
I certainly
from one, and then you realised perhaps an eye-opening moment in your next role, and it sounds like your career's gone on steps. Which, that aligns to what you're saying, Jimmy, doesn't it? Really, if you think back.
Yeah, I don't think they were right from the beginning. They were not planned.
No, exactly. And I think you've seen, perhaps, moving around, going to different sectors, getting your qualifications. You've perhaps seen, oh, I can do that now. Or later, as you said later, people were saying, David, we'd like you to do this. It changed the dynamic, and suddenly you were offered opportunities, whereas you hadn't got, and that's probably down to all this experience, and people said that I can value that experience, we want David. You get an interview, offered the job straight after.
Yeah, and maybe that's where we're not catching up in our industry, where we're still in
that
job for life.
Perhaps that isn't being talked about as well, actually. I've never heard it, a career kind of discussed like that. No, you're always looking at the end point, I think. So
job for life, if you join that, you're going to work for that one company forever. Now it's not like that, so we need to break it down a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that is definitely the case. I don't think there are any jobs for life anymore. And I think the tendency in the job market is people nowadays change jobs much more frequently than they did.
Yes.
Without doubt.
Yeah, and there's a lot more opportunity to jump around. And I think it's encouraged almost. Socially, there's kind of a narrative that, especially recent times, that you can do what you want, work from where you want. And I think that's probably crossing lots of different types of role.
Yes.
Including, you know, welding engineer. So in, let's keep in the UK then, a question for both of you. Which industry in the UK, with the hot topics that the government are talking about, future energy, fusion, nuclear, traditional, the automotive shift to electrification, all transport electrification, hydrogen economy in Middlesbrough, and the electrification, British Volt, just opened up in the northeast. Which industry, as a welding engineer, if you had your times again, I'll ask you first, David. You've just started now, but you're a let's say you're a fully qualified. What would you do now if you had your time again? In today's climate?
Well, I guess the if you look at energy production, I guess, that, which is a hot topic, isn't
yes.
it? And for us to sort of be, I don't know if it'll ever be self-sufficient, but I think that's the aim, perhaps.
Yeah.
So there's obviously the nuclear industry, and it's not just big projects like Hinkley, that you know there are other derivatives of that, and possibly there could be other Hinkleys as well, and probably will be.
Yeah.
And then obviously, wind turbine manufacturing, which seems to be growing and growing and growing. So both of those sectors look very buoyant for the next few years, possibly 10 years plus.
Are we seeing that in our training school with inspection, for example, on the composite blades? Is there a demand for more training on inspection because of the rise in the push for new energy?
Yeah, I think, well, with wind turbine manufacturing, and I'm not an expert, but I think it's relatively straightforward, and probably a lot of it is mechanised.
There's composite engineers listening to this, David. We'll have to cut that out.
Well, next year, we don't like the rest of them.
but I think, you know, with anything like a nuclear build, that's certainly very complicated, and obviously working to exacting standards.
Yeah.
Because I think we all know with the past, if anything goes wrong,
yeah,
it goes wrong and it stays with us for many, many decades.
Yes.
So I think, you know, a lot of our nuclear builds are coming from proven track records, which are mainly French. And to my knowledge, I don't think the French have had any nuclear disasters to date. But anyway, that's you know, those two industries connected with producing energy. But obviously, what's happened in my working life is, and again, I was having a conversation with Jimmy earlier.
Yeah.
When I worked in the oil and gas industry, and I was making drilling rigs. You were just told to go and weld that. No instruction. That may need preheat. No temperature crane or any way of measuring what temperature you preheated it to. And compared to today, I mean, there are so many things in place now where you would be following what's known as a WPS, and everything is monitored to ensure that nothing goes wrong. Whereas, you know, 35 years ago, wasn't like that.
Yeah.
So you're tending to find that welding engineers are required not just in these industries that we hear about on the news all the time. They're required in a lot of industries because quality assurance and quality control is such a big part of manufacturing now. Yeah. We've got to prove that what we're making is not going to go wrong before we even make it. So we've got all these procedures in place and quality systems.
Yeah.
Which, you know, had their foundations, I believe, in the American Air Force during the war. Because at any one given time, only 50% of the planes could fly because they had something wrong with them.
Right.
From a manufacturing process issue.
Yeah.
And then after the war, the Second World War, the Japanese economy took on these quality systems.
And they had a boom.
Yes, yeah. And you know, anything that's manufactured in Japan now is seen as good. And then you had the fast food chain industry sort of take on quality things. So you buy a McDonald's in London, it's the same as one in Melbourne.
Yeah.
There's no difference in quality.
The standardisation.
Yeah, the quality system is there. So an industry has embraced this. And I guess I was fortunate or unfortunate. I was there when industry in the late 1980s started to take on these quality systems. And we were given these things as an example, like Japanese manufacturing and how they've done it.
The Kaizen approach.
That's correct.
Yes.
That's correct. So I think that means that you need more people that understand the process.
Yeah.
You need more welding engineers. But in actual fact, we also need more welders as well. There's a shortage of both. And you just can't fix the problem overnight.
Yeah.
But there is a definite demand.
And I think that's, you know, I'm not saying younger people will perhaps understand or appreciate that, but I think as you get older...
So sitting here as the younger person on this panel,
I'll
get ready
person,
for this.
Yes. No, you know, that's perhaps not the top of their agenda, the fact that there's a demand and there's lots of roles across all industries. And you talk about nuclear there and the SMR project. You talk about the pre-design processes that are put in. I mean, these take years to be assessed, mm-hmm. way before the first building, whenever it is, potentially 2030 or 2035 for Rolls-Royce. But yeah, it's definitely gone that way. And the other end of the spectrum, you've got TVR in Blackpool, the old automotive. I think all industry was like that. And your British Leyland, with the touch and feel process quality control. and classically, that, you know, a lot of that industry went out of business because of that. But the demand, yeah, it's nobody, is that being talked about to say this is a future career, because there's a huge demand?
Do we look at the future of the career in not the right way? I mean, tying into, you know, you were talking about India before.
Mm.
Brilliant example of a country that's on the ascent, coming up with their own ways of doing things. You know, we should already probably be talking about Indian standards rather than ISOs and stuff, because they're big enough market to really drive their own thing. And then we talk about, you know, you mentioned Kaizen coming from Japan and that. Do we need to start seeing our industry and having that base that we have of however many, you know, 100 year of experience, bringing our welding engineers through to being, okay, get that baseline experience to be the engineers who go out to the rest of the world and bring all that knowledge with us? We're not really doing that as a selling point for British industry, I guess. I don't know, I feel that maybe because we kind of got one foot in the past and one foot in the future, but for welding engineering, if we can say, well, we train our people to be the best welding engineers, give them the knowledge from basic welding actually doing the welding through to NDT and the engineering process background, you know, the degree type level thing that we keep mentioning, the IAW and stuff like that, but just degree level education, and then saying, right, your future is maybe not working for companies who actually build stuff, but it's going into those companies and being the key expert.
Yes.
And we're not, I don't think we're selling that very much, because that's what my job is now, really. You know, I'm not working for a company, I work for myself now.
Yes.
I don't, you know, we, our business,
your value is your expertise.
Exactly. And do we not need to move that to be the, you know, the next Kaizen coming out of UK, instead of being, oh, well, we'll use somebody else's work and then try and fight people who unfortunately can't do things cheaper than us and are going to outcompete us from a different standpoint, you know, but don't have that knowledge we have in engineering yet. If we
so
miss
where's,
the ball,
where's
we'll
British
it.
Engineering going then? There's obviously politically, there's an argument and a drive. The narrative is for us to stand on our own 2 feet. As we were perhaps in the 60s with the aircraft, sorry, the 40s and 50s with the aircraft industry. Where's British engineering going, in your view, and is it being invested in enough?
It's
engineering as a whole.
Yeah, it's probably not had the investment that it should. I think. British engineering comes up with good ideas and has skilled people, but it's very difficult to compete with some of the larger European countries.
In automotive in Germany, Jaguar is desperately trying to reproduce a Mercedes, Audi or BMW. But you can't help feeling that they've got a very good product, but whatever sat behind that is, it's not a Mercedes, it's not BMW, and it's not Audi. And why are we, why are we struggling so much if we've got the skills? The Jaguar product is competitive with a like-minded size saloon, German saloon, from BMW, Audi. But why is Jaguar constantly needing the extra investment and not supporting itself, perhaps like those three German companies?
I think the success with Jaguar Land Rover is more recent. And with, you know, Mercedes and BMW, Audi, it's over a much, much longer period of time. And I think they started from scratch. Their factories were flattened. They started with new factories.
Okay.
We had to work with old factories that had several floors and weren't laid out correctly. So from a production point of view, we were never going to be able to keep up with brand new factories in Japan and Germany.
And we've never really caught up. Is that what
I don't think we've ever really caught up.
Fighting, you know, I would use the iPhone sort of argument, and you say, why is iPhone successful? You know, listen to a lot of people, and there was Simon Sinek wrote a book called The Infinite Game. I think it's a brilliant book about, you know, not just playing the short term. Do we play in our engineering field, you know, in the UK, a little bit too much short term? Because it's very much on political cycles rather than it's on, you know, where are we going to be in a country in 50 years' time? It to me, it's what it feels like anyway. It doesn't wrong. But
a
if you
cyclic
long term
lack of investment, and we never really get momentum.
Yes, never, and not a plan to say, well, you know. Come back, taking it in steps.
Yeah.
You know, iPhone, what did they do? Apple, what did they do? They started with the iPod, they moved it on, they always had that idea that they were, you know, or somewhere on there, and they had that idea of the iPhone, and it was a move towards that, where you know, again, it's all in this book. It's not on my head yet. Like,
yeah.
But it, you know, you look at Microsoft and the Zoom, and it fizzled out. A bit more short term, a bit more. You know, are we lost in that? Oh, we have the best stuff. Okay, we do, but we need to realize it. We need to think 5 years time, 10 years time, 20 years time. Where are we moving to? I mean, if you go down the nuclear fission and fusion, is the big drive at the minute. Yeah. I was at a conference just before Christmas, and this came up. It's like, okay, we have the opportunity to be ahead,
yes,
in a technology, and we can do. We are maybe ahead at the minute with the raw tech as it stands, but are we going to push that? Why are we not talking about it? Why are we not saying to everybody, building up that momentum and saying, you know, we've got this tech, we're pushing this tech, you know, the plan is 5-10 years time, this is where it stands out. Get the eyes on it, get people engaged with it. We don't do that because we're British. We don't sell ourselves particularly well. You know, if you talk about why do people buy a BMW? BMW, like iPhone, like all of those big brands have sold, well, you need that. Because if you have that, you have the lifestyle, you have the play around it and stuff like that. We don't do that in anything, do we? We don't do it in our engineering side, we don't do it as a job, as we try to sell the career.
Yeah.
And we definitely don't do it in the technologies we're putting money into. And so we come second.
So the investment in nuclear, fusion and fission, is there an investment at this absolute green ground level for the training? Do you see that, David? So we can see the push and the link with industry. Rolls-Royce leading on the SMR, their supply chain. Is there the real drive and investment that perhaps we're saying there isn't at the training level, the grassroots level? Do you think? Do you think we've committed enough to that, and are we seeing that?
Well, we probably haven't. For the last 4 or 5 years, we've every organisation of a particular size has had to put money into what they call the apprenticeship scheme.
Yes.
And it's not apprenticeships from 16 to 20 or 21. You know, it's apprenticeships at any age,
yes,
in lots of approved disciplines. So we've done that. But I think probably it's quite hard for people to see this. You know, you were talking about my steps. These steps aren't quite laid out. You do an apprenticeship as a welder.
Yeah.
Then what do you do? Well, maybe you want to become a welding inspector, qualified welding inspector, a C-SWIP qualified welding inspector. Then what do you do? Well, perhaps you should look at becoming a welding engineer.
Yeah.
But I think for me, I did not know when I was working as, I'll call it, an unqualified welding engineer, that the welding diploma existed. It was only because a salesman was talking to me,
right,
and he lived in Kent and I lived in Norfolk, so he had been to the TWI, and he dropped in here one day and picked up the leaflets about the diploma and handed them to me. And then I think we had a project for one of our French sister companies, and the French government was involved, and they insisted that somebody had, you know, a level on the IIW diploma. So I had the leaflets, and there was a necessity that I had to do it, and that's how it happened. But that was by mistake. There was no distinct step at all for me. It was just, I just fell into one, into the,
yes,
other, into the,
yes,
other, into the other. Now, I don't know with James if there were distinct steps for you.
No, it's very much the same. Well, I left my apprenticeship, decided I didn't want to be a welder because I wasn't making enough money, you know, full stop. Paid myself through my free one. But the decision to get my free one was very much that might be a good thing to do, but I don't know. I had nobody to talk to it through and discuss it. And then a year later, I fell into a job, yeah, at the Institute. You know, so 22, I started teaching. Just through luck, really, it was, there's a job, we'll put in for that. It's local. You know, I was literally, TWI North, Middlesbrough, was only 10, 15 minutes from my house. Oh, that'll be great, we'll start there. But we don't sell it at all. We don't.
Do you think if you'd had that information, so perhaps an opportunity to speak to people at these various steps, would that have helped you at
I don't know
any
if
point
put
in your career?
Would it put me off?
I think it would have been helpful.
Yeah.
Because I think in other careers they are fairly well laid out. You know, like how do I become a chartered accountant?
Yeah.
I'm sure that's very well laid out. You know.
Yeah.
How do I become a qualified solicitor? I'm sure that's very well laid out.
Yeah.
How do I become a welding engineer? It's not very well laid out.
Yeah.
You know, although it's a discipline that you know. People use this term, he's a professional. Well, I think welding engineers are professional.
Yes.
Like chartered accountants, like solicitors, you know, it's at that level.
Yes.
But it's not laid out very well, how you start and how you get to the finish line. It's just not laid out very well.
And do you think we could attract more young people or individuals at later stages of life if it was laid out more concisely? And more attractively.
I believe
so. Is that the answer? And potentially outreach going into schools, which I know obviously does happen. We're talking at Northumbria. But is it in enough volume?
Doing bits of the STEM and it was a couple of weeks or next week I'll be back in school and we're doing stuff with kids from six up over. We're very good at getting into the schools. You know, you look at how many STEM stuff is, and there's a lot of money, and there's a lot of really good engagement with the kids. But when those kids get to 16, 17, 18, now before they can leave school, what happens at that point? I don't know, I think I might tie it back to your other question, which was, are we doing enough in the industry? Where is the funding going? Okay.
Yeah.
Are we putting money into the bigger companies to support them and not support the smaller? You know, how many SMEs are in the country? The bulk of the industry is SMEs.
Yeah.
Are we supporting that and giving enough finance? Because at the end of the day, a lot of it comes down to finance. Targeted support. So that those smaller companies can support the aspirations of people that we're selling this career to. Because right now, you know, there's some really good companies out there, there's some not as good companies, should we say. You know, how many kids do we lose once we get them into an apprenticeship? Because our apprenticeships are with companies who aren't necessarily engaged in the way we really want them to be engaged. And would that, you know, instead of propping up a multinational, you know, I'm always terrified now running my own company is becoming that term, a zombie company. You know, at what point do we say the money would be better here and we can make that throughput, we can make the next entrepreneurs, we can make the next engineers, we can drive that to help because we may be shouting at a brick wall, it's them to a point if there's nowhere for them to go.
Yeah.
And there is good places, so but is there enough?
You know, there's a lot of support and support we do with TWI, David, in the Middlesbrough and the North East, with SMEs. Are you saying there's a lot more central government funding needed to really, really make it work?
I guess I'm a little hands
in your
off.
In the northeast.
In the northeast, we are, you know, there's money comes in and swaves fairly regularly. You know, you've talks about Northern Powerhouse and all of this type of stuff. You know, where there's always the joke from my side, and you know, the northeast areas, where does the Northern Powerhouse stop? Because it seems to get to the Manchester band, and then, it, you know, north is maybe not north. But money is one thing, funding is one thing. Work, I used to do tech transfer stuff with the teams here 10, 15 years ago, and it's great. But why is it not making momentum? We can keep chucking money at all of this, but if we can't get it to click, we're doing something wrong.
So what would
and
you
what
say,
are we doing
what's
wrong?
What's the answer there, in your opinion, in your geographical location? What would you say to Ben Houchin, for example, who is very pro-industry?
Oh, yeah, there's no doubt about that. There's no doubt.
The funding he's brought to Teesside and all around the narrative on Houchin economy is tremendous. But what else do you need?
How do
we take it so that it's a long lasting?
Yeah.
Now, going back to that up and down peaks and troughs.
I would, you know, a lot of this stuff that's going in globally, but especially in the Northeast, is all about how many jobs does it create, right? It's very easy.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm going to say this just looking out and trying to understand it myself. You saying, okay, so short term, 800 jobs, because you've got all that construction, you've got all that.
Yeah.
Long term, how many people? Because very quickly it drops down to, you know, hydrogen economy. How many people is it actually going to keep employed for the next 20 years in the Northeast? It's great, and it's, I wouldn't say not have it at all, because one job is one job. But do we need to change the Northeast away, you know, again, one foot in the past, one foot in the future. That heavy industry thing, unfortunately, is gone. Will it come back? No, because once it's gone, getting it re-established, getting it brought back, no matter how much we want to, is an uphill battle. So how do we change the expectations? What should our expectations be? You know, we should be saying to people in the North, kids in the Northeast, this is what you can do. How do we do this? What do you want to do? You know, engineering opens up for, you know, for me, I spent a year and a half going back to India, I've been to Japan, I spent a lot of time in Africa working as a lead welding engineer. Loads of time in America, met some amazing people. Again, we're not selling that. We're not raising people's aspirations through engineering.
Yeah.
We're almost stuck with saying, oh, well, we haven't got shipbuilding anymore. We haven't got coal mining anymore. And they were all jobs for life, and they were all good jobs for people.
Yeah.
They're not there. So we need to break away.
With the next generation.
If we're saying hydrogen economy, okay, where can people engage with that?
Yes.
Because at the minute, there's been a lot of, oh, we're getting, you know, we're getting the hydrogen plants, we're getting the giga plant, we're getting this, we're getting that, we're getting a free port. What does that mean to people? Realistically, what does a free port, which is going to be a good boost for the area, to what point? How does the normal person in Middlesbrough, Sunderland, Newcastle actually say, oh, well, I've got an aspiration now. If I do this, I can work there, and from there I can do that.
Yeah. So they're not quite making the connection with the tomorrow's generation.
Yeah.
Although there's efforts being made, but it's not quite.
Yeah,
linking.
No, I know. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Some of our political figures are becoming very engaged in that, and it's what we need. That's the start. We need people being active. Yeah. Some of our political figures in the Northeast are very quiet. It's stagnation, really, more than anything. And I just like to get a hold of these. Just engage, show us where we can go.
Yeah, that spirit probably comes from your entrepreneurial drive, to be honest. And you know, you've set your own business up.
Yeah.
So I think it probably needs a combination of that plus the engineering aspiration of the different steps. Mm-hmm. But I think you've probably got it naturally, setting your own business.
Oh, yeah.
And it comes to you naturally. Perhaps, you know, perhaps it's a historical legacy, socio-economic expectations of the region and constantly being linked back to the heavy industries and the loss of shipyards and heavy engineering. You know, that'll be the same in Glasgow, Belfast, Liverpool, Manchester. Yeah.
Very interesting. Can we change the narrative of these places, which drives them into the future in a way which is going to, you know, and engineering has the way of doing that.
Yeah.
Absolutely it does. You know, we could be the first places to be able to drive, and we're not. You know? So yeah, it's the $1 million question. How do we change the amazing training we have already? Because I guess we have that. We have the introduction into kids and through the STEM programs, which are great. You know, the Institute is very good at giving that really high quality. You know, I teach, so I'd like to say very high quality teaching. You know, there's a lot of passion goes into it. You know, yes. People like David putting their life
and the volunteers of all the branches, as I saw at Northumbria, real passion.
So you look at, say, the Northumbria branch, because unfortunately I can't really mention any other the branches because I don't engage with them very much, but the Northumbria branch, you go from kids, you know, we saw the apprentice awards and things like that, a really good input, you know, 5 apprentice awards given out, I think there was 2 lasses, 3 lads, you know, showing, at least in that generation, we're starting to get a bit of a more balanced outlook coming through into the industry, which is, again, is we're missing. I have a daughter. I'm desperate to make sure she can stand up against that type of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think we're starting to get there slowly, and there's a long way to go. You've got the kids there. You've then got that branch goes up to 80 odd year old. The wealth of knowledge.
The 88th annual dinner, I think.
Yeah. A wealth of knowledge there.
Yeah.
Do we engage with it in a way? And again, I'm almost sitting here, do we engage with it? Do we do this? Not entirely sure. It needs a lot of us to sit down and go, okay, what's the goal? How are we going to get there?
Yeah.
In a main goal we can all get around together, rather than lots of little goals, I'm guessing.
I wanted to try and quantify the scale of things on, because we're talking about welding engineers.
Yes.
How many qualified welding engineers do we qualify in this country per year? And how many does Germany qualify per year? We're lucky if we qualify 30. Germany's near 1,000.
Year on year. Yes. There you go.
I know our economy, although our economy, we're not, if we look at GDP, I mean, we're not that far behind Germany, but our economies are different. Theirs is much more a manufacturing economy, where ours is much more a service economy. But that figure staggered me. Yeah, it's staggering.
Yes,
that figure.
The
route for the Germans is much easier than ours. You know, that's what we're going back to, you know. My route was this step, that step. The route for the Germans is clear. That's where we need to be. We need to make that route much, much clearer.
So, on that, what would you say to someone who's about to convert into this industry, but is perhaps thinking of using their mathematics skills in pushing into software engineering? What's the, each give me a quick, concise sentence why they should become a welding engineer.
I mean, obviously, I'm more biased towards being a welding engineer rather than a software engineer. But I think that it comes down to, you know, very much personal choice. They've both got fantastic roots into being exposed to all sorts of things. Probably as a welding engineer, I think probably you'd get around a bit more. You'd actually see things. You know.
There you go. I'd say that's the answer to it. Yeah, if you're telling me.
Yeah.
It's that travel, I think.
It's that travel, and you'd probably get to meet more people face-to-face rather than on a Zoom conference or something, because you sometimes physically got to see what's being made or what the problems are. to problem solve it.
And perhaps we shouldn't concisely describe the pathways and the steps, because flip it on its head, is it not really exciting to get that next qualification, that next step up, next experience, and then you don't know with welding engineering? And perhaps being a solicitor and a chartered accountant and a chartered surveyor is a bit prescribed. Perhaps that's the exciting thing we need to talk about.
So I would leave it loose, but
you're not sure. But I don't know.
My answer to that would be, well, right now I'm a welding engineer, but we're busy building an app. I'm also, we've got websites, we're trying to put things on there and get engagement for there, knowledge transfer and all that type of stuff. Right, so there is software development in that, and I have a partner in business who's come from over software side, and he's doing that, and I'm moving it. So you can have both. You can use that knowledge of computers and want of any of that to do that. Right?
Yeah.
Then if you more like a legal sort of side of things, well, a lot of the time a welding engineer is sitting there coming up with arguments around specifications and wording and standards and stuff like that. So you're doing that as well.
Yeah.
So you could be doing that. And then you get your travel. And then you get your development and materials and stuff like that. So I would say to somebody, view welding engineering as a key to allow you to do lots of stuff. And what you'll probably find is every day is different. One thing I love about working for myself is I might get David ring us up one day and say, can you come and teach a course? I get another client ring us up and say, can you come and run a weld procedure? Or someone says, we've had this failure in this test. How does that work? Or how can we get around this? Or what size welds do I need to take this weight? Or, if you do the EWE, it's 4 units, design and calc, materials, welding processes, and then the last one is putting all that together. So don't just think about it just being, I'm going to watch a little blue light fly about. Think about, well, the next step in the next 5 years is, how do we model stuff? You've got a whole modeling division at TWI working out through maths. Some really clever people there working out the physics around arc and heat transfer and all that, and building it into a model. If you come from a welding engineering slant on that, you could be an even better welding engineer and open yourself up to do even more.
So opportunity, travel, variation.
I think Jimmy is right. Within a welding engineering role, there are a lot of aspects to it. You know, there's the financial one is pretty important. You have to get things right.
Yeah,
or you could cost an organisation an awful lot of money.
Well, you would just show me that report you did back in 93, which a big part of it was working out the costs of welding
and the savings
from changing the process, and it was not insubstantial amounts of money.
You know, if you go into an organisation that uses welding predominantly as it's to join things, you could save them an awful lot of money. We're just coming up with one or two ideas on the economics of welding.
So
there's that side of it. There's the debating side of it. So the barrister solicitor side of it, which is frequently going on. You've got to be a good communicator. And a lot of UK welding engineers don't work in the UK. They work all over the world. Software engineer 3, welding engineer 7.
Right. Thank you, gents. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you
for your time. And wonderful discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.